It's currently a pretty exciting time in the NES Tetris scene, as a brand new playstyle has just been developed and the community is working on how to optimize it.
Last week I uploaded a video giving an overview. Basically, the two previous playstyles were DAS, holding down the buttons on the D-pad to move the pieces side to side, which can be slow and limiting on faster level speeds, and hyper-tapping, which is tapping your fingers at the rate of a dozen times or more per second to get quicker piece movement. But it's difficult, and a lot of people just can't do it. The new third playstyle is rolling, a special method of tapping which uses multiple fingers in succession to press the bottom of the controller up into the finger on top of the D-pad, and is much faster and more efficient since each individual finger only has to move at a fraction of the speed.
The game's been around for 30 years now, so there's definitely at least a couple people who experimented with something like this in the past, but nobody had ever demonstrated that it was viable to play at a high level with this technique,
until Cheese came along a few months ago, took some time to practice and get consistent at it, and now he's just crushing records left and right and really redefining what's possible in the game, with his channel blowing up as a result.
It's been really cool to see the reaction from other gaming communities to this, because in other games where the speed matters, there's been a lot of similar techniques developed over time.
I got a bunch of comments from people saying this is like rake tapping in Clone Hero, where players swipe multiple fingers across the guitar controller during fast solos. Someone made the comparison to Minecraft, where they said normal clicking is like DAS, jitter clicking is like hyper tapping, and butterfly clicking is rolling. But by far the most special reaction was a video response from Rob Scallon that he filmed on his cell phone, I think literally right after he watched the video.
It's like well past midnight here. I just saw GameScout's video and was just really excited about it.
Someone in the comments there said it gave them early YouTube response video vibes, which is so fitting because yeah, video responses used to be a thing right above the comments in the early days of YouTube. And Rob Scallon is 100% an OG YouTuber. He's been uploading to his main channel since 2007.
I actually first watched some of his videos way back when I was a teenager. I originally knew him as the guy who made the Pogo Bat intro for Dan Brown's channel.
His channel has really taken off in the past decade, with him doing all sorts of musical challenges and explanations. He's launched a guitar course, his own guitar line, done countless collaborations with other YouTubers. He's an incredibly accomplished guy.
And among everything else, he also follows Classic Tetris and has done several Tetris theme videos over the years.
In 2019, he covered the Tetris theme on his special Nintendo guitar with guest appearances from Joseph, Jonas, and Heather. And the following year, he invited Jonas out to film together in person.
I'm the 7-time world champion of Classic Tetris. When that happens, sometimes you collide worlds with a 7-time world champion of random guitar playing.
Yeah. Rob took Jonas into the studio to teach him how to play the drums. And afterwards, Jonas gave Rob a lesson in NES Tetris. And during that conversation, when Jonas was telling Rob about hypertapping, Rob talked about how hypertapping only seems to use one muscle. Jonas prompted him with a question on how he's able to play fast on the drums, and he explained how musicians usually achieve faster speeds by dividing up the work between different muscles. And he actually tried rolling the D-pad, but the buttons on top were too small to roll directly. So what did he have to say once a successful rolling technique was figured out?
I knew it. I really did. Like, one of the first conversations I had with Jonas was, I know there's a better way to hyper tap. I don't know what it is, but like, I remember telling him, like, when I look at hyper tapping as a guitar player and guitar teacher, my gut response is like, that is really inefficient technique. There's gotta be another way to do it, but I couldn't figure it out in the time that I had, or if I would ever figure it out. But moving the rolling to the bottom, genius, absolutely genius. So I have some thoughts from just seeing you do it. I have a few inputs as a bass player, mostly to use some techniques that really help in bass playing that I feel would work here.
So Rob Scallon did have some legitimately great tips for getting better at rolling, especially with my grip, because the technique I showed in the first video, well, there were a lot of areas for improvement. So first, before getting into any of the tips, I should lay out exactly what rolling is trying to accomplish.
So I have the controller directly on my leg here. I don't usually have it straight. I have it sideways to more accommodate the shape of my hand because the thumb's lower down here and these other fingers are higher up. So this is especially helpful if you have big hands. So my pinky finger is actually anchoring the controller to my leg, and then this finger is doing the flips, and then this thumb is hovering over the D-pad, and then I'm tapping on the back of the controller with the fingers on my other hand.
Now the thumb shouldn't be completely limp. You actually want to have the thumb pressing down just enough so that when you bump the controller up, it registers an input, but not strong enough that you're actually causing an input with the thumb itself. Which is hard because it goes against every instinct you've previously learned when playing, which is to press the thumb hard enough to actually have an input. And it's important to note that you don't have to use these specific hands. You can easily flip it to being on the other side, like this. And this is what Cheese does in his grip. I just use the other grip because I was more comfortable with rolling with my left hand. The only problem with this is that it leaves my pinky very little space in order to actually anchor the controller to my leg. And this can be taxing on the pinky, so Cheese's grip, when it flips around, he's got a lot more space on his controller because of all this space right here in order to anchor it down. So you can actually use like two fingers. The only issue is that using a normal controller by flipping it upside down, I'm reversing the direction of all the inputs. Cheese actually uses a Goofy Foot controller, which naturally has the D-pad and A and B buttons on opposite sides for people who felt more comfortable on different hands for different buttons. AMJ Productions, in his early rolling tests, has also been using a Goofy Foot controller. They are actually one of the very few alternate controllers that are permitted in live tournaments. And they're all custom made by Steve DeLuca, who's been a longtime supporter of the scene and this channel. So if it's a controller you might be interested in, I'll have a link in the description to his website where you can get one. And the other thing with rolling is that although you have the potential for more than 20 hertz, which is 20 presses per second, you don't actually need 20 presses. The most you'll ever need to move a piece to the side is 5 inputs, and oftentimes you only need 4 and sometimes 3. Cheese just rolls his entire hand, depending on how many taps he needs. He rolls up to all 5 fingers for one move. Initially, because I wasn't doing the thumb pressure right, I couldn't get all my taps to register, so I was just rolling my middle 3 fingers in succession multiple times for pieces going all the way over to the side. It worked well enough for me to demonstrate that it was possible for the previous video, but it was not the best long-term solution. So rolling is weird. It's like the inverse of traditional hyper-tapping. The speed is not the problem. The speed is easy. The control is what's difficult. And the control is where Rob Scallon's advice comes in. Because in music, a lot of the same principles apply. If you rush through a fast piece without proper technique, it's gonna be sloppy, you're gonna be overexerting yourself, and it's just not gonna be as good as it could be. So here's what he had to say.
When you were doing the rolling, I see you doing this. When it comes to playing string instruments and doing a similar type of technique, you almost never want to do this. When you want to ricochet, which I think in this case you do, you never really want it like this. If you're hitting something with your finger like that, you're losing a lot of energy and it can be a bit more efficient. If, just as you said, by playing piano, with guitar I'll often use like imagine you were holding like a ball. Like you want your fingers to be like that. And striking the strings, or in this case, striking the controller, that way is going to get you more force and you're not going to lose some of it like that. And when you're going at high speeds, losing a little bit of that energy is gonna make a big difference.
Rob is absolutely right here. This is something I probably should have caught as a pianist, but sometimes it takes a second pair of eyes to see it. So having the fingers flat like this, there's a lot more distance and effort required to have them move up and hit the controller. If I have them curled, the fingers hardly have to move at all, and I can notice a big difference almost immediately.
Another thing that I wanted to add, because I am seeing a lot of people doing that, it's just something you really do when you play bass and you're striking strings, is you want to flick the string. Like you hit it and you pull it and then you get to the edge and let it fling back. And that gives you a ricochet. So as you see, if I put this here, you can see the NES controller really isn't moving that much. But if I move it right to the end and I press in and let it flick on the way down, you can see I'm getting it to move a lot more. Actually, let me show you what I'm emulating here. So basically, what I'm trying to do on the side of the NES controller is this. The same technique that you learn to go really, really fast with finger style on bass.
So there's multiple things going on here. First, again, 100% correct that it's better to tap the very edge of the controller, just because of the basic physics of levers. The closer you are to the middle, the stronger the push of the fingers has to be in order to get it to go up. If you're way out at the edge, you barely have to bump it, so it's best to put the fingers as far out as possible. And if you have it tightly held, if you flick your finger out of the way instead of just pushing it up and down, it's gonna go down faster. I did talk about this with another bass player in the community, Pumpy Heart, and he gave the additional feedback that the flick may not be as necessary on a controller since strings stretch and have more plucking action, whereas controllers are rigid. He noted that you also need to pay attention to your wrist angle. Ideally, it should be straight. This is very natural on the bass, but on the controller, you'd have to like crouch down or elevate your knee if you're trying to hold it like this, so it might be best to hold it off on like an angle. And Ruins, who apparently has been secretly practicing rolling the past few weeks out of nowhere, posted an incredible 19.5 clear where he has a grip with his controller
sideways against his leg, allowing for a straight wrist.
Also, I think if you wanted to learn this rolling technique, I think it would really make sense to practice to a metronome so that all your hits are nice and consistent. That'll help you get a lot faster, and then you can practice that way by bringing the speed up. And if you're doing that, then you're just right in line with triplets on a bass. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. You want to get that nice and timed if you want to really, really go fast.
Again, yes, I think this definitely will help.
I noticed when even looking at the example footage I recorded for the last video in slow motion that my fingers were not uniformly hitting in clean intervals. And that's just another contributing factor to dropped inputs. So I've been practicing just rolling slowly with a metronome with my fingers during downtime. I did a stream a few days after Rob's video came out trying to incorporate some of his techniques, and I was definitely better, but I quickly realized it's too difficult to try and remember to consciously do all of these things all at once, and still be thinking about how to stack optimally at the same time. So I'm gonna need to spend some time practicing all this slowly and getting it into muscle memory before I can play properly on the higher levels.
Same thing as how a musician should practice a quick piece slowly and in segments before bringing it up to full speed. And I'd say that for anybody trying to learn rolling. I think it's possible for almost everyone, but it's definitely not easy. Cheese has been practicing rolling seriously for around 6 months now, and he's been practicing stacking and playing at high speeds on NES Tetris for years. And while his world records seem to have made him an early favorite to win CTWC 2021, it is helpful to keep in mind that his world records are often the result of several hours of attempts. And the difficulty of level 29 means it's very hard to replicate this success consistently across every tournament game. So don't put too much pressure on him. Although it is worth noting that he actually has already been doing a lot of Rob Scallon's tips. He's curling his fingers, he's hitting the very edge of the controller. Now the big difference is that he's rolling with his entire hand instead of just the three fingers like I was doing. Three fingers can work for four or five taps if you practice for it, but full hand rolls do seem to be setting in as the most common method for top new players. Doge, who got the second max out in 29-2 done with rolling, has a great slow-mo view of his thumb coming in first from the side and swiping out, and then his three middle fingers curl a roll, and finally his pinky just boinks up for the last tap. Since it's the final tap, it doesn't need to immediately move out of the way. As a fair warning, this is the opposite way Cheese does it, and the direction you roll your fingers has often been a bit of a hot topic in the community discussions. And there's other grips that people have been working on too. Jerpadude has a grip that's pretty similar to a Das grip, where he rolls with fingers on the same hand as his thumb on the D-pad. And he's even able to get a five-tap roll by incorporating his middle finger from the other hand at the end. Zipley, who's known for his unusual hyper-tapping grip, has also developed what he calls the Zipley rolling grip, where he anchors the controller by wrapping the cord around his leg. Hector Fly, who I mentioned at the beginning of the previous video and has been rolling on track and field since 1983, has even uploaded a tutorial of his own two-finger NES grip that he was actually able to get to work on the D-pad with 20Hz speeds. He hasn't done it on Tetris though. Tegamek, who also experimented with two-finger grips in the past, uploaded a response critiquing that technique, with some of his points being that there's a longer delay in getting your fingers in the right position and the grip is more prone to missed inputs. But Guerrero Astiff has actually posted some promising results with a virtually identical grip. So although full hand rolling appears to be the optimal technique, if it's not something you can get to work, Hector's method may be a possibility.
This has really become a whole community effort to figure out the best method of rolling. So if you would like to participate in learning rolling and join the discussion, the main place where it's happening right now is in the Classic Tetris Monthly Discord server. I'll have a direct link in the description to the rolling channel where people have been uploading videos and swapping tips and advice. And I'm thankful that Rob contributed to the conversation. It felt like getting a guitar lesson from Rob, except it was for Tetris, but it was still relevant. It's so strange and so cool at the same time.
Rest in peace, Jonas. We love you so much. See you at CTWC.
Well said. See you at the CTWC.